A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy. Here are the list of news articles taken up for discussion today, and the video is time-stamped for your convenience. Let us move on to the first article for this day. This one is a short data-intensive discussion on the effects of the pandemic on the females. This COVID-19 pandemic has been unmerciful on all sections of the society, regardless. Especially, it has dramatically changed the lives of women and girls in the marginalized section. To establish this fact and to list out difficulties faced by the adolescent girls and young women in this pandemic, a study was conducted, and this news article is all about the findings of the study only. The report of the study is titled as COVID in Her Voice, a girl-led and centered participatory research study. It was conducted among the adolescent girls and young women from marginalized societies across seven cities, namely Ahmedabad, Alwar, Bareilly, Delhi, Lucknow, Mumbai, and Pune. The findings have been aligned with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, so it will give us an idea about how far we are in achieving the targets under SDGs and the pandemic's adverse impacts on that. First, SDGs considered are SDG 5, which is about gender equality, and SDG 10, about reduced inequalities. The study has found that the pandemic has exacerbated the existing inequalities for adolescent girls and young women. It has intensified the effects of patriarchy and gender discrimination, especially in the aspects of increased unpaid care work. What is unpaid care work? Unpaid care work is like child upbringing, taking care of the elders, cooking, and other household work. And early marriage, exclusion, neglect, and the closing up of spaces for mutual support and solidarity. That is, the females are not getting enough support from their family members. Worryingly, about 80% of girls said that the household chores continued to be only their responsibility. That is, there was no participation from the men from the family. Next is SDG 3, about good health and well-being. According to the study, adolescent girls and young women faced many challenges ranging from uncertainty to social isolation and parental fear, and all of them affected their mental health and capacity to manage their emotions. Around 90% reported experiencing mental distress and despair, including depression, lingering sadness, lack of confidence, loneliness, and helplessness. So have a look at this graph. And 53% reported that they could not visit a doctor when they needed to. So their access to healthcare was severely restricted or limited during the pandemic. Next is SDG 4, which is about quality education. Around 64% of adolescent girls and young women do not have the space or get the time to study online. There is 18% school or college dropout rate due to COVID-19. So the inclusive education that is being envisaged by the country is being missed by this pandemic. Next is SDG 8 on decent work and economic growth. It was found that economic stress on families due to pandemic and lockdown has a direct impact on the future prospects of the girls. About 59% reported that their income had been affected at personal or family level. And finally, it is SDG 11 on sustainable cities and communities. Public places within the cities are off limits for girls also because of their threat of violence. So, 49% reported decreased mobility and they faced increased barriers. About 26% also believed that there has been an increase in gender-based violence. So, on a whole, these are the challenges faced by the adolescent girls and young women due to pandemic. So, have a look at this graph, which is based on age. See, the youngest chunk is based on the pink color and the orange-ish yellow is between 15 to 19 years, which is the adolescent period. And the 20 to 24 is the purple. Along with these findings, the participants have given certain recommendations or advice on how to make the society a better place for adolescent girls and young women. And it has been summarized here for your reference. So, from the discussion, some facts that I've discussed in the discussion is very important from the exam point of view, especially from the mains point of view. And the recommendations, as we see, is very important from the exam point of view, especially mains again. With this information, let's move on to the next topic. So coming to the second article for this day, this editorial is about vaccine diplomacy during the COVID-19 pandemic. See, this is also about pandemic, but it is about a slightly different topic, the vaccine diplomacy. See, in this analysis, we'll see why India is opting for vaccine diplomacy. In addition to that, we will also discuss the issues concerning the vaccine diplomacy that was adopted by India. So this is the syllabus for your reference. See, the vaccine diplomacy is the use of vaccines to improve a country's diplomatic relationship and influence of other countries. During the recent pandemic, the vaccine diplomacy has taken center stage in many countries' foreign policy. So when it comes to India, so as on April 13, India had supplied over 65 million vaccines to 90 countries. Of these, more than 10 million were sent as grants, almost 36 million on a commercial basis, and about 19 million under the COVAX program. These are the official estimates given by the Ministry of External Affairs statistics. So taken together, these supplies come to around a month of India's current COVID-19 vaccines production. The problem is currently, India is facing vaccine shortages at many places. People are not having access to vaccines and are paying very high prices to get them. So many have started to question the rationality of exporting vaccines during this difficult times. In this context, let us see the official explanation given by the Government of India sources justifying the vaccine exports. See, according to the government, the export of vaccine is done factoring in the domestic production requirements of national vaccination program and the requests for made in India vaccines, which could be from abroad. So, by factoring in the above variables, the government is making sure that the vaccines are available for domestic consumption without any hindrance. Only the surplus vaccines are being exported according to the government sources. In addition to that, the government also stated that it is supplying vaccines to Gavi's COVAX facility as an obligation since India is a member of this multilateral body and is also recipient of vaccines from this body for various other immunization programs of India. And let us see what is COVAX and Gavi to have a better understanding. See, COVAX was launched in April 2020 by World Health Organization, commonly called WHO, the European Commission and France in response to COVID-19. So it's a very new body. See, COVAX is an effort to ensure that people in all corners of the world will get access to COVID-19 vaccine. COVAX is co-led by Gavi, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, CEPI, and the World Health Organization, working in partnership with developed and developing country vaccine manufacturers like India. So what is Gavi? Gavi is a global vaccine alliance, bringing together public and private sectors with the shared goal of creating equal access to the new and underused vaccines for children living in the world's poorest countries. So it brings vaccine closest to the poor people around the world. Its core partners include the WHO, UNICEF, the World Bank, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So coming back to the article, see, the export of vaccines is a necessary noble during this pandemic. By doing that, India is showing the world that it can lead and aid others during the times of crisis. It shows that India is a responsible global power which does not obsessively think of itself alone. Also, the export will make sure that there is an equitable access to vaccines. And equitable access to vaccines is critically important because no one will be safe until everyone is safe when it comes to COVID-19. Also, the export of vaccines is in line with our constitutional principles and values envisaged by our leaders. In addition to that, it also strengthens the value of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. See, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam means the world is one family, and this is an integral part of Indian value system. And this is enshrined in the Indian values, making India morally obligatory to supply vaccines. So this justifies the vaccine exports. Now let us look into why the vaccine export is a bad thing and why is it being severely criticized. So as we have discussed, the vaccine export was based on three factors: the domestic production, the demands of the national vaccination program, that is the domestic demand, and the request for vaccines manufactured in India, that is the for the export. But what is not known is what is the weightage given to each of these variables in the decision-making process. This exemplifies that there is a lack of transparency in the decision making. Also, according to the government, it was obligatory to send vaccines contracted under Gavi's COVAX facility. But sovereign states can always invoke the supreme national interest to override these obligations. That is, a national interest can always override its obligation to export the vaccines. So when it comes to the vaccines sent as grants, they were voluntarily, and the commercial contracts of the company concerned could always be disregarded under the existing Indian laws. So, the justifications provided by the government are insufficient. Specific clarifications are needed to convince the people that these exports have not been made at the cost of their health. Keeping the people reassured, secure, and informed during the crisis speaks the essence of the democracy. So this article, this editorial, chiefly centered around the vaccine diplomacy and why vaccine export is a good thing and why vaccine export is a bad thing and why the nation has to find a balance between both. That brings us to the end of this discussion on this article. Our next discussion will be based on this editorial article. See, this news article talks about the power equations that are existent in the world order currently. Author has run the readers through the power equations that was governing the world previously and the ground power relations and the possible future trends in this regard. So in this slide, let us see some important points in the article. Here is the syllabus for your reference, students. And from the exam point of view, this will help you understand the power balance in the world and thereby you will have a better understanding of the international relations. So that is how this topic is important. So let's go on to the discussion. Around the 14th and 15th century, Europe began dominating the world through its trade and commerce. And in 500 years, it managed to colonize and influence almost the entire world. However, in the post-colonial era, people began questioning the Europe's notion of Eurocentricism and the biased accounts about the East. So all these culminated in freedom struggles, and this led to the struggles against the Western-centric perspectives. We all know after those decolonization commenced, that is, Britain started receding. So it was in Bandung Conference of 1955, a meeting of the Asian and the African states, most of which were newly independent at that time. So this conference set the schema for the rise of Asia politically and economically. However, the British dominance came to an end only with the Suez Canal crisis of 1956. During the crisis, the Britain and France took a backseat and the America took up the wheels. That is, Pax Britannica transitioned into Pax America. That is, peace that was once maintained by Britain is now and will be maintained by America. That is, America became the global police. And since then, America began to hold a strong position in the world order. And we know, till now, it continues to play a prime role in the international affairs, even though its image of universal brotherhood faced a sharp decline under Trump regime. So, especially his foreign policies and all were severely criticized. We know that. And the halo of benevolence that the US carried has seen some serious reversal under his regime. Particularly his foreign policy of threatening to withdraw from NATO and withdrawing from Paris Agreement on climate change was received very poorly by the global audience. It was only worsened by his racist stance and his condescending opinion on the immigrants who contributed to their nation, etc. See, at present, with the rise of ultra-nationalism and ethnic purity that was seen around the Brexit times and the promotion of right-wing agenda, and the concept of liberal democracy has begun to face a serious disintegration. So apart from this, threats like terrorism, ethnic conflicts, and the warning of destruction owing to climate change also proves the need for a joint international action, that is the unity that is required from the parties, that is nations. But the self-centered stance or the exceptionist stance, as the author calls it, see, exceptionist stance is nothing but thinking that I am an exception, where the global coordination and collaboration is needed. For example, when US decided to withdraw from the Paris Agreement, see, it considered itself as an exception. So this exceptionist stance has also dented America's image. With these misadventures, the present situation demands a more decentered and a pluralistic global order where there is no one particular global polis. And this can be understood with the rise of Asia. Here, the author factors in the China. See, in the post-pandemic world, the emerging economies like ours and Brazil's and South America's, etc., have been challenged very seriously. And these economies, with their recovery, they will join, or they are expected to join, or they may join the US-led liberal world. But there is this rise of China having the potential to mount the challenge to this axis. But the China's intentions are viewed with doubts. For instance, the BRI, the Belt and Road Initiative, has been viewed with suspicion by India, Japan, and many other democracies also. So besides the China factor, the author also talks about the possibility of military conflicts, that is the Chinese infiltration and the Russian adventure in Ukraine, etc., are all classic examples that military skirmishes are potential possibility with the economic rise of a nation. By mentioning this, the author emphasizes the need to have a global collaboration in a multifaceted fashion. So when you take the present scenario, both India and China have the potential to lead. And this is evident in their history itself, because they have been pioneers of some of the oldest civilization in the world. We know that. And remember, the future global politics demands a practical plan for rising powers who are looking for new centers of power with the decline of American ascendancy. Now, let us see the aspects that should be considered by China for spearheading Asian regionalism. So, we know that China poses to be a valuable partner when it comes to challenging the West. And most importantly, when America could no longer hold the global governance all by itself. And as per the data from International Institute of Strategic Studies, the overall estimate of China's military budget was found to be about $230 billion. And this reflects China's intention for global supremacy, mainly to outrun the Pentagon or the US Defense Department. See, the author sees China to have the potential to lead or co-lead in the world order, but it first has to shed the prejudices that the West has created towards the East. And besides that, China has to match up to the economic, political, and military prowess of the West to project itself as a viable counterweight. And above everything, China should also act as a responsible power, rising above the self-centered attitude. And the author finally concludes the article by mentioning about the dualism which persists in the world order, where no clear hegemony can be bestowed on one single nation. See, this word hegemony has been finding a repeated mention throughout this article discussion. Hegemony is nothing but dominance. Okay, so and though there is a fear of multipolar world turning disordered and unstable, it is up to the rising nations should not be overzealous in expanding themselves territorially and thereby causing any disputes. Because as we saw earlier, the present challenges need mutual sharing of knowledge and a more inclusive treaties, like the challenges like the climate change or terrorism, etc. That's what the author mentions here. So that brings us to the end of this discussion on this particular editorial. Look at this news article. Recently, the US administration under Joe Biden had announced that it will pull out all its troops from Afghanistan by September 11. And this article is a discussion based on that. So to understand the significance of the decision, let's first understand the Trump-Taliban deal. See, the Trump-Taliban deal is an agreement signed between the Trump administration and the Taliban. According to this deal, the US troops will pull back from Afghanistan by May 1st. In return for the Taliban would not let terrorist groups such as Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State operate on Afghan soil. This deal was significant because it brought Taliban as a stakeholder in the peace talks. So it was also seen as a key effort in ending the 18-year war in Afghanistan. See, this deal was signed by Donald Trump, but when Biden became the US president, there were doubts whether this would be honored, which was signed during Trump's presidency. But with the recent announcement, President Biden has effectively upheld the spirit of the Trump-Taliban deal rather than defying it. And this decision by Biden is significantly important because along with the US troops, the thousands of coalition troops under NATO's command are also expected to be pulled back along with the Americans. Now, coming back to the article, such a huge withdrawal of troops will leave the democratically elected Afghan government alone on the battleground against the Taliban. See, the Afghan country is already witnessing a series of targeted killings of journalists, activists, and other civil society members opposed to the Taliban. With the withdrawal of troops, these killings are expected to increase many, many times. And this will shift the balance of power decisively in favor of Taliban. And also, the US air power was a very crucial element in driving the Taliban back, especially whenever they attacked the cities. With such support, Taliban attack on important Afghan cities will increase manifolds. So what is the way forward? Because the US cannot have its presence perpetually in a foreign soil, right? So the US should continue to give its assistance remotely to the Afghan government. This will deter Taliban from carrying out attacks on innocent civilians. And from the international perspective, the role of regional players such as India, which is a neighbor, China, Russia, will be very crucial in deciding the Afghans' future. These countries have shared interest in a stable Afghanistan. So by aiding the Afghan government in its fight against Taliban, they are ensuring the peace and stability of the region. So peaceful and stable Afghanistan will be beneficial to the entire world's peace and security. So that brings us to the end of the discussion on the Taliban-Afghan topic. Now let us take up this Ground Zero article as the last discussion for the day. This article is written based on reports on the paramilitary forces, which talks about the twin challenges faced by the Assam Rifles, which includes checking smuggling and preventing illegal crossing into Mizoram while overseeing the much delayed and the ambitious Kaladan multimodal transit project. So in this light, let us know some facts about Assam Rifles and the Kaladan multimodal transit project. See, there are seven central armed police forces, seven. And the Assam Rifles is one among them. They are fondly called as Friends of the Northeast People. The force is the highest awarded and the decorated paramilitary forces of the Republic of India. And it emerged way back in 1835 with just 750 men to primarily protect the British tea estates and their settlements against the tribal raids. And since then, it has gone on to fight in two world wars, a Sino-Indian War of 1962, and it is also being used right now for the anti-insurgency operations in the Northeast. At present, its purpose is to guard the Indo-Myanmar border and to conduct counter-insurgency operations in the Northeast region. And it is headed by an officer of the rank of Lieutenant General of the Army, appointed as the Director General. Remember, the headquarters of Assam Rifles is located in Shillong and it comes under the control of Indian Ministry of Home Affairs. Now look into the Kaladan Multimodal Transit Project. Look at the map for a better understanding. See, it connects the Sitwe Port in Myanmar in the India-Myanmar border. The Sitwe Port is the capital of the Rakhine State. See, the Rakhine State, which we usually come across in news due to the Rohingya issue, that is located in the southwestern Myanmar. This project is expected to open up sea routes and promote economic developments in the northeastern states and also to enhance the India and Myanmar ties. The importance of this port is that at present, the only way to ship goods to the landlocked northeastern states from the rest of India is through the Chicken's Neck in the West Bengal, which is a narrow strip of Indian territory between Bhutan and Bangladesh. See, this is the Chicken's Neck and it is the Silguri Corridor. And with the emergence of this project, the new route is expected to lower the expenses and the travel time and distance from Kolkata to Mizoram and beyond. So this will be through Myanmar. Also, the project is not just confined to connecting Mizoram to Myanmar, but also encompasses India's expanded outreach to the prosperous Southeast Asian economies and to build robust partnership through India-ASEAN trade. So this project can be said is in line with India's lookist and atheist policies. So students, here we are at the practice question discussion session. We have only two questions for discussion for today. So let's go into the first question. So first question, with reference to the UN Sustainable Development Goals, consider the following statement. The concept of SDGs was agreed at the Rio Plus 20 summit. See, this statement is correct. So let's know more about SDG. SDG is the common acronym for Sustainable Development Goals, we know. And the concept of SDGs was agreed at the Rio Plus 20 summit in 2012. So as mentioned in the statement, and it was held in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. It is also known as the United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development. The Rio+20 outcome document called for the SDGs. So what is very unique about the SDGs is that the SDGs are global in nature. That is, they're universally acceptable to all the countries. So we know various countries are at different levels of development and they have different national realities. So this goals takes into account all these things, and thereby these goals have a common understanding of the universal realities. So come to the next statement. The goal 5 of SDG is to achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls. So statement 2 is also correct. So I advise the students to have a rough idea about what each goal is about in the SDG. So these can be used in your mains answers also, and you might have a possibility of getting these in the preliminary also. So this question asks which of the statements given above are incorrect. So we just saw that both the statements are correct. So the correct answer will be option D. So coming on to the next question, consider the following statements about Assam Rifles. So we discussed Assam Rifles in our discussion today. So it is one among the Central Armed Police Forces. So this statement is correct, and it is headed by an officer of the rank of Lieutenant General of the Army. So we saw this statement also in our discussion, and statement 2 is also correct. So see, this is headed by Lieutenant General of the Army, but it comes under the Ministry of Home Affairs. Keep this in mind. So this is a factual question, and the correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. So these are the main questions for your consideration. You can write the answers and post it in the comment section. So with this, we are at the fag end of the discussion. The description box has the link to the notes. Refer it for your reference. And you can write the answers for the mains question and post it in the comments section. As we know, pandemic is showing its ugly face again. Wear masks. Be conscious of social distancing. Stay indoors as much as possible. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Good day.